we, of course, are moving into our next conversation this morning. This time we're talking cryptocurrency, Bitcoin, and the Central Bank of Nigeria. There are new laws, there are new regulations and decisions by the CBN to stop banks here in Nigeria from trading and allowing the trading of Bitcoin and cryptocurrency. We've invited this morning Mukhtar Mohammed, a financial analyst, and also Buyi Tudors, an advertising and marketing expert, to join us. Good morning to you both, Mr. Mohammed and Mr. Tudors. Thanks for joining us.
Hi, good morning.
Good morning. Always a pleasure being on the program.
Always. I'm going to start with our advertising and marketing.
Good morning, joining you. Good morning.
Thank you so much for joining us. Oh, actually, maybe I should start with Mr. Mukhtar Mohammed. Some people have called this an attack on fintechs in Nigeria, and seeing where the world is going with, you know, new, you know, types of currency exchange, new innovations here and there. People here in Nigeria say this is, you know, an archaic behavior and, of course, an attack on fintechs. Do you agree with that narrative?
Not at all. Not at all. We're just making noise out of nothing, because what the CBN just said is not that he banned cryptocurrency trading in Nigeria. He said he banned his own financial institution, those that they are regulators, from transferring in anything that has to do with cryptocurrency. So, and let's be honest, this ban has been on since 2017. They just re-emphasized it to re-emphasized the ban. So it's not something new, and it's not stopping anything from fintech. We need to know that cryptocurrency is just part of the blockchain technology, and fintech is almost also part of the blockchain technology. When you think of real-time exchange and real-time transactions, so it has nothing to do with trying to get ourselves up. Other best world, the second largest economy in the world is China. China doesn't do any trade on that. And even Canada doesn't do that. Even in the United States, how much transaction do you have in Bitcoin? In terms of Bitcoin transaction, how many of those transactions do you have in Bitcoin? So we must not be so emotional because of the traders that are actually doing so much, making so much money in Bitcoin to the detriment of the economy of Nigeria. We must be sincere with ourselves. We must ask ourselves sincere questions. We must be patriotic enough to look at the economy holistically instead of looking at our own selfish desire that we want to gain. Look, it's a very volatile transaction. We are in an economy that is even more infrastructures. So we have those challenges that come with Bitcoin technology. It has nothing to do with fintech. Mm-hmm. If you look at the transaction that we've been doing through the fintech in terms of online transaction, over the years, and even this last year, even during the lockdown, Nigeria has gone up almost 200-something% in terms of that. So it has nothing to do with that. I think everything has to do with the volatility and the risks involved in cryptocurrency. And that is what the government is trying to guide investors. It's not saying that you cannot trade in cryptocurrency. I need to re-emphasize that. It's only saying they own financial institutions that are under the regulators, under them as regulators. They will not allow them to trade on that cryptocurrency asset. Mm. Basically, that's what the CBN will say.
Let's bring in Buyi Tudors on this one. What are your reactions to what Mukhtar has said? And basically, your reactions generally to the government's announcement on Friday?
Mukhtar has made a lot of great points that I agree with. Because the CBN in itself is a regulator, and cryptocurrency is built on cryptography, which is not to regulate it. And they are definitely within their merit, you know, to stop institutions that they regulate from trading in these things. But what we need to understand is that cryptocurrencies are the future, in the sense that cryptography answers a lot of questions that money does answer. You know, it's a store for value. You're able to exchange it for transactions, and you're able to edge it against the naira. So what I have an issue with is that the overall strategy for the CBN is to make the naira as strong as possible against the dollar. But by taking out, you know, last year, cryptocurrency in Nigeria traded over $553 million, right? Now you're taking that out of the economy, you're taking that out of the power of the naira. This would inadvertently lead to, you know, a devaluation of the naira, because the dollar will go stronger. Because just what the thing is, you have not banned cryptocurrency. What you've just done is banned the use of naira by cryptocurrency, which means that people will start looking for alternative means to get cryptocurrency. And usually what would happen is that they will use the dollar, you know, as this alternative. And what happens then is that the dollar becomes scarce the dollar becomes overvalued, and then the black market rate of dollar becomes higher. Now, what's going to happen is that it's going for dollar dependent merchants who can't now find dollars because they're not super expensive and scarce. They will circle back to cryptocurrencies. You even have cases where, you know, Chinedu and Chibuzor in Alabama market are already buying things with Bitcoin. In fact, Chinese people, Chinese exporters would prefer conversations in Bitcoin even more than dollars, right? So you're going to, at the end of the day, create a circle that keeps devaluing the naira, because now people are looking for dollars to buy currency, and now because it's scarce, people are now buying cryptocurrency like stable coins, USDC, BUSPX, to now buy goods and exchange your goods. So it's literally going, it's just basically a conundrum. So I don't agree with the tactic. You know, if your overall strategy is to strengthen the naira and then you're taking tactics that weakens it, that's where my issue is. So rather than ban, rather than hinder, why don't you, sit down at the table with these cryptocurrency traders and decide on a framework for transparency, a framework for legalization, a framework that helps you monitor these transactions, if that's the issue. If there are so many exits, why are you closing yours, right? If your exit was the only exit, it would make sense to your end goal. But if the exits, why are you closing yours? Why not bid fires and then tax it and put a certain levy on it?
I'm going to bring in Mukhtar, to also share on that. Do you, think that maybe the CBN, could have found another way around this instead of, the policies and the ban that they have, currently placed, on the financial institutions here? Is there ways that they could have looked at the value that cryptocurrency trading does actually bring to our GDP and to Nigerians and to small businesses, across the country? And then, of course, created policies instead that would help protect investments here in Nigeria and that wouldn't scare away investors from Nigeria and, of course, still let the, the cryptocurrency market continue to thrive?
Well, I heard what my colleague just said, but when you look at what you're talking about, cryptocurrency adding to the GDP, we don't seem to see that happening, or we've not seen that we have the GDP of Nigeria being released by the NBS every quarter. We've not seen crypto add anything to our GDP. In terms of making crypto a means of exchange, you need to realize that crypto is like a back behind the scene transaction. I, Mukhtar, can be transplanting with Anita. Anita doesn't even know that Mukhtar. So it doesn't give a lot of credibility to crypto currency when it comes to trading with one or two people. Then when you look at the legality of it, you need to look at legality in terms of holistically. Crypto is a currency that doesn't want to be regulated. There's no fundamental, there's no value chain in terms of how you want to regulate cryptocurrency. So the CBN should not be the one now trying to see how they can regulate a sector whereby the CBN are battling with other frame to make financial inclusion. Cryptocurrency cannot help us in financial inclusion, because when you look at the value in terms of the worth of one cryptocurrency to even the dollar, to place of a naira, so it doesn't help. Then look at what he was saying about using crypto as a means of aging the naira. Look, you might be shocked to know that CBN took this decision because they looked at it realistically and look at that. It could have been the reason why the naira is taking a lot of battle, because you know that this cryptocurrency is not stored in naira, it's stored in dollars. And you're talking about Nigeria being the second largest traders in cryptocurrency, about $500 and something million. You can imagine $500 and something million in exchange for a naira. Now, what does the CBN do? If you close those accounts, and the people decide that, look, we want to withdraw those accounts, then that means that they will have to change it from dollar to naira. So that in turn will have in circulation about $500 and something million trying to change to naira so that it could be of value to them. So definitely that could help also even bring down the exchange rate volatility that we are seeing. So CBN must have looked at all this. In terms of regulation, no part of the world that they've been able to regulate cryptocurrency. No part of the world. So even in the most developed economy, they've not been able to come with a legal framework on how to regulate cryptocurrency. Because cryptocurrency is, like you said, it's a digital currency, it's in space. Now, we don't have only Bitcoin, we have other means of cryptocurrency. Which of them will you not take? Bitcoin just controls about 68% of the cryptocurrency in the world. So it's not just about it's not just about Bitcoin, So which of them will you not? The other 22% of those people that control Bitcoin, how do you find get them? And you should know that more of this currency will keep coming. So the wall itself cannot keep pace with cryptos, because just before 2 weeks ago, crypto was selling for almost 40 something, about $40,000 for one coin. And all of a sudden, within 2 weeks, it has gone down to about $20,000. So you need to look at that volatility, and that's what the CBN is looking at. There's no regulatory. Well, if you looked at a lot of things that have happened, even in terms of terrorism, in terms of fraud that recently involved some Nigerians, you realize they were trading in crypto. They were saying you cannot know the end user, you just do a transaction. That gives room for a lot of fraudulent activities. The regulators all over the world have not been able to control the flow of cryptocurrency. They've not been able to regulate cryptocurrency. And that is why it has not yet been globally accepted. Until you are open to regulation, then you begin to say, okay, now we can globally accept it. We know who is doing transaction with who. We know when a terrorist is doing transaction. We know when a genuine NGO is doing transaction.
All right. Is
that backside of it that has not been covered. That is the challenge.
All right, Mutam, even though, you know, lots of, you know, cryptocurrency traders would argue that basically the whole essence of cryptocurrency is the fact that it's based on the blockchain technology, which is that everything is protected, your identity is protected, and all of that. But let's bring in Mr. B. Tudos now for this next one. I'm trying to find out from you your perspective on what should now be the fate of cryptocurrency traders, because we see a report here saying Bitcoin ban traps 214.5 billion naira in banks. So what's the fate of cryptocurrency traders now, whose accounts are going to be closed?
So what is the fate of these people that their accounts are going to be banned? Well, I think their fate is clear. Their accounts are going to be banned and they're going to have to lose money, or I don't know what legal framework is around that. I'm not necessarily familiar with that. But I think it's a bit backward for that to happen. If people are going to be losing their hard-earned money because they're trying to, for several reasons, buy cryptocurrencies. You know, so I was going to even just address what Mr. Mukta said about Bitcoin being so-and-so amount of dollars. Now, in the crypto world, there are coins called stable coins, right? There are coins that are pegged on the US dollar. There are coins that are pegged on Bitcoin itself. The USDT, the PX, and these are coins that have no volatility. Now, people that go into coins that have volatility understand the risk. And in general, life, there's high risk, there's high reward, and there is low risk, low reward. So it really depends on your appetite, right? For even in the world, currencies all over, you know, what we call fiat in the crypto world, currencies all over have different forms of volatility, right? So 2 years ago, the dollar was doing 363 naira, this year it's doing 485 naira. 5 years before, it was doing 185 naira. It's an area itself not volatile. I think this is the trend all over the world that is determined by market size, demand and supply. Where demand and supply meets is always the price point, right? And if in the long term, cryptography answers the question of store of value. In the next 10 years, I can assure you that the graph will always be polygonal, which means that it will always go up rather than go down. Okay. If the government is in, the top five countries in the world are embracing cryptography. There's a reason why they are embracing cryptography. The whole idea of cryptocurrencies is DeFi, which is decentralized finance. Now, after the Second World War, the US was trying to determine the tone of money. A lot of meetings had to be had to balance money out, you know, to properly put things in place. And this is the question that cryptography is coming to answer, where everybody can trade globally with blockchain technology that is not based or regulated by one particular country, or and the tone of economy is not determined by a certain country because of the power they have.
All right. I want you to also go on and share your thoughts on the argument about it being used to fund terrorism and the likes. Do you think that we have enough percentage, you know, of terrorism that has been, of course, funded through Bitcoin and crime that hasn't come there through Bitcoin? Do you think that we have enough of that to create enough fear for the CBN to make these laws?
So the truth is that any currency can be used to fund crime. We've heard of cases where Naira was used to fund crime. We've heard of cases where dollar was used to fund crime. We've heard of cases where pounds were used. Any form of exchange, right, can be used to fund crime, can be used to fund terrorism.
Okay, let's bring in Mr. Mukta
here. So I don't think it's a unique thing to cryptocurrency.
All right.
Okay. Let's bring in Mr. Mukhtar here. Just over the weekend, the presidency released a statement talking about how it was going to push for digital economy, the digitization of the economy, you know, to move Nigeria forward, especially towards recovery from recession. But Bitcoin is the future of digital economy. So what are your thoughts on this seeming double standards?
Well, when you talk about Bitcoin being the future of digital economy, you're talking about in terms of currency trading. When you're talking about digital economy, we're talking about a holistic economy, not just economy that has to do with just trading in currency alone. So we're talking about holistically looking at your economy, trying to digitize your economy. Bitcoin itself is just more or less part of the digital economy that we're talking about. So for me, I don't think that negates the fact what they are trying to do. When you look at the whole idea of the cryptocurrency transaction, what's the future of cryptocurrency, is the currency of the future? We keep saying this all the while, and I like saying something about when we have a challenge, when we have the Swiss gold came hand in hand trying to battle with the normal gold, and at the end of the day, we don't have anything less Swiss gold. So it definitely will vanish away when you have trying to play with the major powers of the world. Now, let's look at cryptocurrency itself. How many of these cryptocurrency do we have in circulation? It's up to 21 million. So that's why you see the higher the demand, the higher the price. So how are we talking about a nation? We're talking about different nations. We're talking about a crypto that is run based on, like, when you're doing trading on the platform of an exchange. That's what we are seeing. When we talk about stock trading, we talk about when you trade, when the higher the demand, the lower the demand, maybe a lot of people are demanding for that stock at that particular time, the price goes up. When a lot of people are not demanding for that stock, the price goes down. You can't leave your currency by that. You can't begin to determine your currency all by people that can edge it and say, look, we must edge it at a point. So cryptocurrency is a medium of exchange that has not been globally accepted. One. Then in terms of acceptance, it must be liquid. When we talk about liquidity, we are talking about if I have a card that is carrying cryptocurrency, I can go to China and be able to transact my business. As long as I cannot take that card to any part of the world and transact my business, it is not liquid. So once it's not liquid, it's not good for investment. Investment is all about liquidity. It's about when I want to exit an investment, I should have the right to exit my investment at any time I want to. Not that when I want to exit an investment, I have to wait for somebody else to come and help me to exit them. You say, oh, we are looking for buyers. Crypto is not liquid yet. So that is my basic point to investors that want to invest in crypto. It's all about, like, you are investing in the stock exchange. It's all about you are investing in a business that is run in cyberspace by people you don't know. We not look at the genesis of cryptocurrency. It was some certain boys, it started in Japan. Then some certain boys in America decided to have money for an NGO. And they realized that, oh, can we do this thing through digital? And that's why it came about, and it people started buying into it.
All right, Mr. Mukhtar, we're running out of time.
But we're talking about regulation.
All right. All right. I want $2 to quickly, in 30 seconds, speak on the fears that this, you know, might turn and these type of regulations can chase away investors from, you know, the country. Do you agree with that, or do you think that this would all fizzle out and we're fine? 30 seconds, please.
Okay, so I think what this will just do is, you know, take more from the economy than it will give, because people will start looking on the, you know, ways to buy these things on the hand. You literally can't stop people from doing things they want to do if you're not banning the entire process. Now, they'll look for other exits, they'll look for other means to buy this thing. So, you know, I don't know what the end game is, but I don't see it doing exactly what they're trying to get to do.
All right. And final 30 seconds from Mukhtar Mohammed.
It will not stop investors from coming to Nigeria, like I said, because we need to know how many crypto investors are really in Nigeria. After CBN released this thing, and Nigerian Bureau of Statistics have not given us the number of people that are investing in cryptocurrency in Nigeria. That's why we keep saying that this is sharing a lot of secrecy. So we need to know how much they contribute to the GDP of Nigeria, how much they bring in terms of foreign direct investors or portfolio investment. That is when we begin to see it will have an effect. But as a standard, based on data we have and every available information we have, it doesn't have any impact on the foreign direct investment or portfolio investment in Nigeria.
All right. Mokhtar Mohammed, thank you very much for your thoughts and for sharing with us. Of course, to Mr. Tudors, Buyi Tudors, is it Buyi?
Yes, yeah.
Thank you. Buyi, I beg your pardon. Thank you also for stepping in and for sharing your thoughts also.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Absolutely.
Have a great day.
All right, we'll take a short break now. And moving away from cryptocurrency, we are going to be talking more on female genital mutilation. And we're looking at an in-depth story, a short documentary that was done, you know, that shared the story of a few who have suffered from FGM. We'll be back after a short break.